हेलो डायना केरी डायना है ना डायना केरी डायना केरी कोई कोई कोई
कैमरा स्क्रीन हाँ
है बताओ बताओ हेलो, कॉल का माय फ्रेंड.
हेलो.
Good afternoon and warm welcome to Prayog Rajana 2021, a webinar series organized by Rajana Sharira Department of VPSV Ayurveda College, Kottakkal. This is our second session. We have Dr. Diana H. for this session. For the welcome speech, I request Dr. Bindu KK, ma'am, to deliver the welcome speech. Over to you, ma'am.
Good afternoon and a warm welcome to the second day of our webinar series. It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Diana, Associate Professor, Sri Bapuji Ayurveda Medical College, to today's session. And she was here with us in our department 2 years back. She was a dedicated lecturer and was also one of the favorite teacher of our students. And today she will be speaking about the history of anatomy and the preservation techniques. And as you all know, history of anatomy is not included in your syllabus, but you should know how each medical system was evolved and developed into present system. You might have heard about the Acharya Sushruta, who is a great scholar and surgeon, and he is known as the father of surgery. And Sushruta, in his book Sushruta Samhita, emphasized that mere theoretical knowledge is not enough to study anatomy. But for one to get to know the human body better, one must dissect the body and learn. And you will be surprised to see that in a book which was written almost 5,000 years ago, Sushruta has not only mentioned the criteria for choosing a body for dissection, but has also explained about the techniques that can be used for preserving the body. And few of the modern instruments used in surgical field are the modification of what he had described. I'm not going to the details. Dr. Diana will be detailing all this. And I hope today's session will be an interesting one for all of you. And I happily welcome Dr. Diana to this session. And once again, welcome all And thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. About Dr. Diana, she is currently working as Associate Professor in the Department of Rachana Sharira, Bapuji Ayurvedic Medical College, Shimoga, and has published many articles in various reputed journals. She has presented few papers in national seminars, and she is pursuing her PhD in Parul University, Gujarat. Also, she has published a book on Notes of Rachana Sharira for undergraduate students. I welcome you, ma'am, for today's session. Over to you, ma'am.
Welcome, Dr. Diana. Sorry for the interruption. You are not audible.
Madam, am I audible now?
Ah, yes, yes. Now it's okay.
Good afternoon, all. First of all, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to respected Principal Jayadevan sir, HOD Bindu madam, and other organizers of the webinar for inviting me for this session. The topic for my today's presentation is History of Anatomy and Preservation Techniques. Okay, so the question is, where does the history of anatomy start? From ancient period itself, people were eager to know about the structure of the body. The history of anatomy dates back as early as Stone Age. If we take some of the stone paintings of the Stone Age, which was before 30,000 years, we can see that some of these stone paintings represent anatomy of animals. The study of anatomy dates back to 16th century BC in ancient Egypt. In ancient Egyptian medical text called Edwin Smith Papyrus, we can get references regarding the heart, liver, spleen, etc. structures. In ancient India also, we can get references regarding the study of anatomy. In Veda, we can get references regarding many structures. One of the important references is the structure of or the shape of the heart is told that it resembles with the lotus bud. And in Upanishad, we can get the references regarding this embryo. Ayurveda is evolved in the post-Upanishad period. And this post-Upanishad period is considered as the golden age of Indian medicine. Many Samhitas were written during this period. And all these Samhitas devoted one separate section called Sharirasthana only for describing the anatomy. In Sharirasthana, we can get the references regarding not only the gross anatomy, but embryology, histology, etc. Acharya Sushruta believed that there could be no rational medicine or no safe surgery without that thorough knowledge of anatomy. And in Sushruta Samhita, we can get the references regarding the techniques of human cadaver dissection. He explained the methods of selection of the cadaver, the method of preservation of the cadaver, and also the method of or the procedure of doing the dissection. He did dissection in such a systematic way that he could explain many of the structures of the body and also including the layers of the skin. He did rhinoplasty, which is a plastic surgery done for reconstruction of the nose, and he is considered as the father of surgery. But these Samhitas remained unknown to West till late 19th century. Hence, the Samhitas did not get the kind of attention which they actually deserve. The nomenclature, methodology, and application of anatomy all dates back to ancient Greek. It is claimed that the Alcmaeon who lived in 5th century BC had practiced human dissection, but none of his works on this dissection are available. He identified the optic nerve and Eustachian tube. Hippocrates, the father of medicine, believed that the knowledge of anatomy is the fundamental part of clinical practice, and he identified that blood vessels are emerging from heart, but he could not distinguish between arteries and veins. Later the Greek philosopher Aristotle, he wrote the first book on embryology. He named iota, and he could distinguish the arteries and veins. But he considered heart as the seat of intelligence instead of brain. Another one Greek philosopher called Praxagoras, who lived almost in the same period of Aristotle, he studied Aristotle's anatomy and improved it. He could distinguish between arteries and veins, but he believed that arteries are emerging from heart and veins are emerging from liver. But the relations between organs are explained more accurately by him. During that period, Alexandria was one of the important or famous centers of learning. In Alexandria, special importance were given for medical science, and the first school of anatomy was established in Alexandria in 4th century BC. Herophilus and Erasistratus were the most brilliant anatomists of this school. They contributed greatly to the existing knowledge of anatomy, especially in the anatomy of brain, nervous system, eye, liver, reproductive organs, blood vessels, and lymphatics. Before the period of Erasistus and Herophilus, physicians were not practicing the dissection, human cadaver dissection. It may be because they thought that it is unethical, or maybe due to religious reasons. But Greek emperors had an ambition to establish the Alexandria as the glittering center of scientific learning. So they handed over the dead bodies of the executed criminals to Herophilus and Erasistratus for exploring the knowledge of anatomy. Herophilus was considered or regarded as the first person to do the systematic dissection of human cadaver. And this was a remarkable moment in the history of anatomy. And Herophilus is considered as the father of anatomy. The other contributions of Herophilus include, Herophilus contradicted Aristotle's notion that the heart is the seat of intelligence. Instead, he told that it is not the heart, brain is the seat of intelligence. And before the period of Herophilus, various strands of the body, like the ligaments, tendons, nerves, all together were called as sinews. But Herophilus distinguished nerves from other sinews by tracing them back to the spinal cord and brain. He could also identify the cranial nerves, ventricles of the brain, and also he distinguished the sensory nerves from motor nerves. He identified that brain is the center of sensation and locomotion. He identified that blood is present in both arteries and veins. Before the period of Herophilus, anatomists thought that arteries are containing pneuma and veins are containing blood. It may be because after death, most of the blood will get accumulated into the veins. So early scholars thought that arteries are containing pneuma and veins are containing blood. But Herophilus told that both arteries and veins contain blood. He told that arteries, and he also identified that arteries having distinct coat. That is why arteries are thicker than veins. And he was also interested in pulse, and he developed a water clock to measure the change in pulse rate when the patient gets fever. And it was Herophilus who named the first part of small intestine as duodenum. After the period of Herophilus, the dissection also ended. It may be due to two factors. One is the later school of thought believed that the human cadaver dissection is not necessary for the teaching of anatomy. And also, the books of the Herophilus were stored in the library of Alexandria. This library was burned, and all the works of Herophilus got destroyed by this. The findings of Herophilus lived in the works of later scholars, especially Galen. The Claudius Galen was one of the best physician during that period. Galen was known for his experiment approaches in exploring an interrelationship between the anatomy and physiology. But most of his anatomical knowledge were based on dissection of animals. He also identified that both arteries and veins are containing blood. He also studied the functions of kidneys and spinal cord. Galen identified that the ligation of a peripheral nerve will lead to the motor or sensory loss in the area of its supply. He also demonstrated the function of recurrent laryngeal nerve experimentally. He identified that blood must pass from right side of the heart to the left side, but he was unaware of the pulmonary circulation. During medieval period, due to the widespread introduction of the Christianity, human dissection was prohibited. So physicians could only follow or repeat the findings of the previous scholars. They could not question the validity of these findings. So the search for new knowledge become temporarily stagnant, and the Middle Ages is hence called as the Dark Ages. Considerable advances in the field of science could only be attained after 12th century, when some universities are established in Oxford, Paris, etc. And from 12th century, church also did not forbid the human dissection. During 13th century, the Roman Emperor Frederick II made it mandatory that at least one human cadaver should be dissected in every 5 years for anatomical studies. This was a giant initiative towards the revival of anatomy, because the realization that the human anatomy can only be studied by the dissection of human cadaver led to the legalization of human cadaver dissection in many of the countries. Renaissance period is the transitional period from Middle Ages to Modern Ages, and this period is characterized by the rebirth of science. During Renaissance period, many artists also did human cadaver dissection to better understand the human body. Leonardo da Vinci was the originator of cross-sectional anatomy, and he was the first to explain the moderated branch of right ventricle. During Renaissance period, anatomists were performing the dissection. But even though the main aim of dissection during this period was not to add to the existing knowledge, they blindly followed the written text instead of looking into the real anatomy which is visible in the dissected cadaver. They believed that it is below their dignity to perform dissection in the human cadaver, and the dissections were performed by the barber surgeons. But these situations came end dramatically by the end of 15th century. In 16th century, the Andreas Vesalius was a reformer of anatomy. He started his career as a defender of Galenism at the University of Paris. And he started doing dissection by himself for teaching his students. He wrote the book De Humani Corpus Fabrica, which was a milestone in the history of anatomy, and he is considered as the father of modern anatomy. Popularity of dissection started spreading to general population, and huge crowds were attending the public dissection sessions. This led to the establishment of anatomical theaters. From 17th century, due to the continuous dissection of human cadaver, there was a rapid growth in the development of anatomy. And many inventions were also made by great scientists. In 1628, William Harvey wrote a book on motion of heart and blood. In this book, he documented his theory on circulation. Before the period of William Harvey, it is believed that blood is passing back and forth through the blood vessels. But William Harvey told that blood circulates, do not pass back and forth through the same blood vessels. Robert Hooke recognized and named the cells. Later, the Antony Leeuwenhoek improved the microscope, and he could visualize the fine strands. He could magnify and visualize the fine strands of tissues. This opened new frontiers in the research of anatomy. He described the blood cells, spermatozoa, and skeletal muscles. The study of anatomy further improved by the development of histology, and Marcello Malpighi is considered as the father of histology. Robert Brown recognized the presence of nucleus in the cell, and cell theory was postulated by Schleiden and Schwann. The cell theory states that all the living organisms are made up of cells, and cell forms the basic unit of all the living organisms. Later, Rudolf Virchow added that cells come from pre-existing cells. Gregor Mendel did many experiments in plants hybridization, and he is considered as the father of genetics. Henry Gray published his Gray's Anatomy in 1858. Even today, this book is the basis for most of the medical students. And after publishing his second edition of Gray's Anatomy, he died of smallpox at the age of 34. In 1895, Van Rontgen used the X-rays to detect the bone fracture and also to assess the extent of tuberculosis. Advances in radiological technologies like PET scanners and MRI, it helped the physicians and also the surgeons and scientists to visualize what is inside the body without performing surgery or dissection. And this also helped the researchers to make remarkable connections between the anatomy and physiology. It also helped to integrate the anatomy with other disciplines like genetics and biochemistry. Over time, many scientists attempted to improve the knowledge of anatomy, and they made many new inventions, and their names are often added with the structures or diseases which they discovered. These are some examples. These terms remind us the monumental efforts which these scientists made for the development of medical science. While there are many methods for teaching of anatomy, but human cadaver dissection adds a three-dimensional view to the student's knowledge. It also helps to strengthen the concepts introduced in the lectures. After the legalization of human cadaver dissection, dissection became the vital tool to understand anatomy and surgical training. So there was a scarcity in the cadaver for dissection. These circumstances encouraged the malpractices like grave robbing, body snatching, and even murders for dissection. To put an end to these unethical acts, many acts were enabled in different parts of the world. Murder Act in 1752 legalized the dissection of bodies of hanged criminals. But even though this act cannot satisfy the demand of cadaver, as the number of medical colleges were increasing. Hence, Warburton Anatomy Act was passed in 1832. That is, this act legalized the dissection of unclaimed bodies. But later it is found that this act is distinguishing between rich and poor, because most of the unclaimed bodies will be of poor. Hence, in US, another act was enacted, that is the UAGA, in 1968. The Uniform Anatomical Gift Act allowed a person to make an anatomical gift at the time of death of his full body or a part of his body, either for medical studies or for organ donation. And different programs organized by the UAGA promoted the body donation, and due to this, the demand of cadaver was satisfied by the end of 20th century. And different programs of the UAGA also helped to maintain a respectful and compassionate attitude towards human cadaver. The other developments of anatomy in modern India include Dr. Mortimer of Madras Medical College wrote the book Mortimer's Manual of Anatomy, which precedes the Cunningham Manual of Anatomy. And Madhusudan Gupta is credited as the first dissector, and it was also Asia's first human dissector. In past, there were only very less number of medical colleges, and number of medical colleges also increased in India with time. And there was a demand for human cadaver for dissection. Hence, Anatomy Act was enacted in India in 1949. So due to the enactment of all these anatomical acts and body donations, the demand for cadaver was satisfied in most of the medical colleges. But one of the important prerequisites for using a cadaver in an educational setup is the proper preservation of the cadaver. Here comes the importance of embalming. Embalming is the treatment of a dead body so as to sterilize it or to protect it from decay. For 5,000 years, human beings are trying to stop the after-death decay of the dead body. They used to apply many spices and aromatic substances over the body. Hence, the name came as embalming. The term embalming means to put on balm. But whether earlier anatomists were using some embalming techniques to preserve the dissected cadaver is not known. Ancient Egyptian people were doing mummification to preserve their body for afterlife. These are the different processes involved in the mummification. At first, they removed all the internal organs except heart. Then the body will be kept into a salty substance called natron. In that salt, the body will be kept for almost 40 days. Later, the body will be taken. It will be treated with alcohol and many spices. And the body will be filled with sawdust. And later, the body will be filled with sawdust To lessen the lifeless appearance, the body will be filled with the sawdust. And later, the body will be wrapped with linen cloth. The references regarding preservation of human body we can get also in ancient India. In Ramayana, it is mentioned that dead body of King Dasharatha was preserved in Tailadroni until the return of Bharata. And we know that the preservation techniques, dead body cadaver preservation techniques, are well explained in Sushruta Samhita. He explained the selection of the body. While selecting the body, he told that we should select a body with normal anatomy. That is why he told that we should not select a body of a person who is died due to poison or who is died due to chronic diseases, or who is aged over 100 years. So he told to select the body of a with having a normal anatomical features. And later he asked to cover this body with some medicinal plants. And these plants, recent researches shows that these plants are having antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory and healing properties. And most of these plants contain tannins. The tannin is also a preservative. Later, after wrapping the body with the medicinal plants, he asked to keep this body in a slowly flowing water. So here, this slowly flowing water is also important because the water makes the skin moist and soft. And the water offers a cooling effect to the body so that decomposition of the body will be slowed. And also in a slowly flowing water, the microorganisms formed will be continuously washed out from the surface of the body. Even today, many researches are going on in hydrodissection. Hydrodissection is a modified form of Sushruta's method of dissection. It is inspiring that Madan Kumar sir of Government Ayurveda College Trivandrum is also doing research in this concern. During Middle Ages also, people were practicing different methods for preservation of human cadaver. These are like immersion of the body in alcohol, insertion of preservative herbs into the incisions, and wrapping the body with wax, etc. And this practice of embalming, by injecting fluid into the blood vessel started only after William Harvey described the theory of circulation. And the discovery of formaldehyde and introduction of formaldehyde as a preservative were important steps in the history of embalming. Embalming causes the coagulation of tissue proteins so that these tissue proteins will get fixed and hardened. Different uses of embalming includes for the purpose of dissection in medical colleges, when the dead body need to be transported from one country to another country, and also to preserve the dead body of some important personality for public view. Now, the constituents of preservation fluid. The preservation fluid contains, or the embalming fluid contains, first the preservatives. The preservatives inactivate the saprophytic bacteria, and disinfectants are chemicals which kill the microorganisms. Modifying agents control the action of the preservatives. These include buffers, humectants, and inorganic salts. Dyes impart color to the preservation fluid, and perfuming agents reduce the harsh odor of the solution. And diluents are liquid in which the other ingredients are dissolved. The modern methods of embalming include conventional method, refrigeration, plastination, PLS method, cryopreservation, and saturated salt solution. The conventional method include different steps. First is arterial embalming, next cavity embalming, hypodermic embalming, and surface embalming. When we do the, when we anatomically embalm the body, we will do the anatomical embalming of the body in a closed circulatory system. The fluid used for preservation usually contain formalin as a preservative. This embalming fluid containing formalin as the preservative will be injected into one of the major arteries. Preferably, we use the carotid artery or femoral artery. Now, embalming fluid can be injected into these arteries by using two methods. One is the gravitational method, other is the embalming method. By using gravitational method, fluid will be slowly introduced into the vessels over an extended period of time. And by using the embalming machine, we can inject the fluid in high pressure in a short duration. And When we embalm the cadaver by using formalin, we can see that the cadaver will be having a grayish discoloration. This is due to formaldehyde grave. That is, when there will be a reaction between the blood and the formaldehyde, which leads to this grayish discoloration. The embalming fluid can be made by through different compositions of these ingredients. But this is one of the composition which we usually use in medical colleges. And see, in gravitational method, the container with fluid will be kept above the level of body. It will be elevated above the body, and one rubber tube will be connected to that, and the fluid will be injected into the vessel over an extended period of time. And we can also use the embalming machine. By using the embalming machine, we can inject the fluid under high pressure within a short duration of time. The other methods of embalming include, or other steps of the preservation or embalming include, the cavity embalming, hypodermic embalming, and surface embalming. These are supplementary to the main method of arterial embalming. Means if we find that the arterial embalming is not enough, we can also take the help of these methods, that is the cavity embalming, hypodermic embalming, and surface embalming. In cavity embalming, we will aspirate the fluid from different body cavities, that is the peritoneal cavity, thoracic cavity. We will aspirate the fluid from these cavities by using an aspirator. Later, the concentrated formalin will be introduced or injected into these cavities by using a probe cup. Next is the hypodermic embalming. In hypodermic embalming, the preservation fluid will be injected below the skin by using either single injection or multiple injections. In surface embalming, we just apply the preservation fluid over the surface of the skin. The surface embalming is mainly used in injured body parts. So refrigeration is another one method of preservation, but this method is usually used in very cold countries. Another one method of preservation is plastination. In plastination, what we will do, we will remove the biological fluid, and this will be replaced by the plastic polymers. We will remove the biological fluid and we will replace this by the plastic polymers. The different procedures of the plastination include, first, we will do the fixation of the specimen. In fixation, we will preserve the specimen or cadaver by using any of the conventional method, as usually how we preserve like that. We will preserve the specimen or the cadaver. Later, the next step is the dehydration and defatting. This can be attained by dipping the specimen in acetone. Next step is the forced impregnation with the plastic polymer. And next is the curing. Here, curing means hardening of the specimen. It can be done by either by using fire, gas, or heat. So the benefits of this plastination are, the specimen obtained by plastination will be having these properties. That is, the complete visible surface with high durability. It will be dry, odorless, and resistant to damage caused by the frequent handling. It allows the students to make hands-on experience in this field without exposure to chemicals such as formalin. These are the benefits of a specimen or cadaver embalmed or preserved with plastination technique. Elnadi technique is a modification of plastination technique. One of the drawbacks of the plastination are, the plastination is an expensive process. In also, we have to, while doing the plastination, we have to maintain the temperature and vacuum. But in LNAD techniques, the chemicals used are inexpensive and they are locally available. And we can make the specimen by using this technique under the normal temperature, normal room temperature, and also the vacuum is also need not have to be maintained. The procedure is almost same as that of the plastination. These are some of the specimens preserved by using this technique. Next preservation method is the cryopreservation. The cryopreservation is a newer method of preservation of 21st century. Here the cells, tissues, or even the complete body is preserved by keeping them in a low sub-zero temperature such as -130 or -196 degrees Celsius. Here two things are important. One is the low temperature. That in such a low temperature, all the biological process will be end. The will not take place. All the biological process will end, including the cell death. So there will not be any cell death. Next is the cryopreservative agent. So with the specimen, we will add the cryopreservative agent. So this cryopreservative agent will protect the cells or tissues from freezing damage. Means any damage. So there will not be any damage to the cells, even though we are keeping these cells under such a low temperature. This protection is offered by this cryopreservative agent. So the procedure of the cryopreservation is again the same. That is the mixing of a cryopreservative agent with mixing of the specimen with the cryopreservative agent. Usually the glycerol is used as the cryopreservative agent. Then the specimen will be cooled to a low temperature. This is usually done by using the liquid nitrogen. Now, whenever we need this specimen, the specimen will be washed and the cryopreservative agent can be removed from the specimen. So many people have preserved their body by using this cryopreservation, but it is not for anatomical studies. It is with an expectation that newer technologies will develop and they can live again. It is surprising that almost 250 bodies to 50 people have preserved their body by 2014 through this method. So usually for anatomical preservation of the cadaver, we are using the formaldehyde as the preservative. But recent surveys shows that increased exposure to formaldehyde can lead to leukemia, ENT illness, brain cancer, etc. It can also increase the risk of asthma and respiratory tract infections. So researchers are always trying to find out a newer technique or an alternative to the formaldehyde as preservative. So some of the alternatives have been discovered, like glutaldehyde, ethanol, glycerin, etc. But even though these methods are costlier than the formaldehyde preservation, some other methods used for reducing the formalin in the embalming solution are, one is the TL method. Here, what they are doing is the quantity of or percentage of formalin will be reduced. Instead, a mixture of salt will be added to the preservation fluid for preserving the cadaver. This method is also called as soft fix embalming method. The benefits of this method include the lifelike flexibility of the body part. We know that when we preserve the body by using formalin, if the joints and tissues will get hardened. Here, by using this alternative methods, we can get the lifelike flexibility of the body parts and no detectable odor, excellent color preservation of muscles, viscera, and vasculature, and superior antimicrobial preservation properties are also identified. So this is one of the composition which they used in one study. The process of this preservation is almost same as that of the usual embalming what we do. That is this insertion fluid. The preservation fluid will be injected into one of the major arteries, and later the body will be kept kept in the immersion fluid. But this method is having some disadvantages, like the chemicals used are poisonous, inflammable, health hazardous, environment unfriendly, like that. And its cost is also high. So another one method, the studies are going on in another one method called saturated sad solution. Here, the quantity of or the percentage of formalin is reduced. Instead, common salt is used. for preserving the body. So as the common salt is easily available and inexpensive, this method is accessible. So this is one of the composition of the fluid, of the embalming fluid, which they used in one of the study. So again, the advantages of preserving the body with the saturated salt solution include: the cadavers were excellently preserved and the color remained natural. It maintained the shape, texture, and softness of the tissues and joints. This method is simple, involves low cost with low risk of infection. The hazardous effect of formaldehyde was reduced by medicine dissection, convenient to both students and instructors. So this, the first A and C are the preservation, are the specimens preserved by using TL method, and these two specimens are the specimens preserved by using saturated salt solution. Even though now also we are using the formaldehyde as a preservative in the embalming fluid, so an alternative solution to formaldehyde or newer methods are need of the hour in the embalming process. For this, many research work need to be conducted in this field. So the primary medium for teaching gross anatomy to medical students had been the dissection for centuries. But nowadays, many countries are trying to replace the human cadaver dissection with virtual dissection at cyberspace and radiological imaging techniques. But these methods cannot substitute the cadaver dissection, because the cadaver dissection is the most powerful means for delivering the fundamental topographical, regional, and relational anatomical knowledge to the medical students. The past eminent scholars who discovered and developed the present knowledge of anatomy should be remembered for the physical, mental, and social challenges which they faced during the course of their research, sometimes which even cost their life. So while going through the history of the anatomy, we can see that in past, the anatomy was more theoretical and logic-based. In due course of time, it adopted many practical methods of learning. In future, the anatomy need to be more clinical oriented so that it can do better in the future care of patients. Let us expect the future advancement in anatomy will make it possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Diana, for your excellent presentation and for sharing your valuable knowledge with the participants. It was really an enlightening session. Once again, I express my thanks to Dr. Diana.
Thank you, madam.
We would like to take up a few questions. Participants are requested to type questions in the chat box. Madam, we have a question from Suhana. Why the history of anatomy is important to medical students?
The history of anatomy is important to medical students because study, sometimes when we teach the students or when we study the anatomy, we will, even though we study, we may find it difficult to understand or difficult to remember. It is because, see, there are two things. See, when we understand the anatomy, one thing is, we know that this, I told that the function of this Galen, when if we take the function of recurrent laryngeal nerve, explained or demonstrated the function of recurrent laryngeal nerve experimentally. How he did it, he identified that when he cut the recurrent laryngeal nerve in a squealing pig. It suddenly stopped crying. So he identified that this recurrent laryngeal nerve is having the function of production of voice. So in such a way, when we identified or studied, understand the anatomy and the and when we study the things, we, it will be better for remembering the things. So it will be easily, we can, so it will help us to understand the signs and also to remember the things. And another one thing is, so it helps to make a relation between the science and the student. When we see a person, we will not remember him, but when we know more about him, we will be remembering him, or and a relation, a method of a relation will be formed between them. So in the same way, by knowing the history, it will help to make a relation between the student and the science, and also to create an affection of towards the science. So like that, so that when we understand and the in such a way, when we study the science with an affection, we can understand or remember the things more accurately, or it will find more accessible to remember and study the science, whatever be the science, not only anatomy or any science.
Madam, another question from Dr. Lakshmi Nalinakshan. Why particularly femoral artery or the common carotid artery is selected for arterial embalming? Is there any anatomical significance?
We are injecting the fluid in a, when we are injecting by using embalming machine, we are injecting in high pressure. Or we are injecting almost 10 liters of fluid. So we can inject this fluid only to a major vessels. We cannot inject the fluid to some radial artery or like that small arteries. Here, the relevance of the femoral artery and common carotid, these arteries are very super, or almost superficial, means we can accessible, and these are very bigger arteries, so that we can easily inject the fluid into these vessels. We can easily access these vessels, and also we can inject a large quantity of fluid into these vessels.
Participants, if you have any more queries, please raise now. Hope no more queries. Madam, you have made the students to travel from BC to the present era, made them to understand various preservation techniques that are adapted in different periods, and the common procedures which are using right now, and even the Sushruta's method of dissection, which is now it is tested as hydro dissection. These are well explained, and it's my privilege to express gratitude to Dr. Diana for the valuable knowledge sharing session, as well as the clarification of doubt. And thank you all the participants, all the students, as well as faculties, those who are joined with us. Especially I express my gratitude to Dr. Pradeep sir. He is my first teacher of anatomy. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable presence.
It was nice, really nice. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Diana, it was nice. It was really good. Very elaborate and knowledgeable. I enjoyed listening to you after many days.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all. By this, we come to the end of second session of Prayoga Rachana 2021, and the next session will be on 9th of July. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you.